of business. It's therefore now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Parents across Ontario still don't know what to do since this government has turned their back on children with autism. Parent and professor Janet McLaughlin has said that legal avenues are being considered in terms of filing human rights complaints. She said they are looking to challenge this government for discriminating against children with autism just because of their age. This would not be the first time the Liberals have fought parents with children with autism in the court. And, Mr. Speaker, I would not be surprised if the Liberals are ready to go to court again. After all, their member from Mississauga-Streetsville did call the police on a parent with a child with autism.
Right on.
So, Mr. Speaker, will the Liberals be fighting parents in the courtroom instead of giving children the help
Question.
They deserve?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So, on this side of the House, we are focused on making sure that every child with autism gets the services that they need, Mr. Speaker. Otherwise, we would not be investing $333 million, Mr. Speaker. It is our focus to make sure that kids who are sitting on a waiting list, and you know, it really is surprising to me that the opposition, both opposition parties, think it's better to have children sitting on a waiting list getting no service than actually getting service, Mr. Speaker.
I'm asking everyone to come to order. I will have to repeat from yesterday if I will. I will do that quickly. Your choice. Finish, please.
We recognize that every family needs to have an assessment, needs to be in contact with a provider, Mr. Speaker, that the transition needs to be clear to parents. All of us have been meeting with parents, Mr. Speaker. The minister has been working
Answer.
To make sure that each family gets the information they need so their children can get the services
Thank
they need.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. Over the long weekend, I sat at a Tim Hortons in Mississauga with Melanie Pelipon and her husband, Clint, and her son, Xavier. When they were there, the husband, Clint, couldn't stop crying in the crowded Tim Hortons. And he said to me, he moved to Canada a decade ago thinking that this is a country where if you work hard, that if something happens, there'd be a social safety net that you could depend upon. And he said to me,
Minister of Tourism, Culture, and Sport.
You know, and the government can heckle as much as they want, but you know what? He told me that all they wanted was to talk to their government representative, their Liberal MPP, to explain what this means that IBI wouldn't be available for their child, Xavier. And the Mississauga MPP apologized. But only after it
Question.
Was exposed on the front page of the Toronto Star.
Right.
Only once CTV's Paul Bliss exposed it. So, Mr. Speaker, the family asked me to ask today
Thank
if
you.
The Premier will apologize. Be
seated, please. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, the member has apologized. It is unacceptable to me that a member would not, that any member, quite frankly, any member in this House would not meet with parents who are concerned about their children. We are all doing that, Mr. Speaker. A meeting has been offered to the family. And as I said, Mr. Speaker, we are focused on making sure that every family in this province with children with autism have the information that they need, that their children get the services that they need, Mr. Speaker. It was unacceptable, and it is unacceptable to me, Mr. Speaker, that we would have children on a waiting list for 2, 3, 4 years getting no service, Mr. Speaker, and no support. So we are putting in place a program, Mr. Speaker, that will allow those kids to get the service that they need and to get it in the time frame that is the best for
Answer.
Them and the most effective in terms of treatment, Mr. Speaker. That's what we're focused on.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, what is unacceptable is that your government callously kicked 2,200 kids off the list
Deputy House
IBI.
Leader.
And my question was not to hear more government talking points. My question was the family. The family wants an apology. They wanted an apology from the Premier. It was the Liberal Party representative that instead of meeting with a family in tears about seeing their child's life thrown away by this government because IBI won't be available despite waiting 3 years on the list, Melanie's wish is that the Premier today in the Legislature will apologize for the despicable actions for the member from Mississauga-Streetsville. It is never acceptable for a member to call the cops on a constituent. Meet with that constituent. Help that constituent.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, you know, in this instance, the member has apologized, Mr. Speaker, and you know, the reality is that we all have constituency offices, Mr. Speaker. We all know that we have to take advice from the police in particular circumstances. This was not one of them, Mr. Speaker. The member has apologized and has offered several dates to the family for a meeting, Mr. Speaker. And you know, I hope that the family will take the member up on that and we'll have a meeting with them. Mr. Speaker, we are focused on making sure that every child in this province with autism gets the service that they need. And you know, the member opposite, I hope, is having the opportunity to talk with families and to give them the information.
Member from Leeds Grenville, come to order. Wrap up, please, Premier.
We know that these are families that are in transition, Mr. Speaker.
Member from Dufferin-Caledon, come to order. And the minute I sit down, somebody else says something, I'm going to warn you.
Listening to the families, and you know, one of the issues that they have raised is the issue of direct funding.
Member from Leeds Grenville is warned. We're inching closer. Carry on.
One of the issues that families have raised has been direct funding, Mr. Speaker. We're talking right now about whether there's a possibility of providing more direct funding. The $8,000 is direct funding. Is there a way that parents can have more choice? That's the kind of listening that we're doing because we want to make sure that we get this transition right so that every child gets the services that they need.
New question. Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. And let me say I'm disappointed that the Premier won't apologize to the Palipon family, despite a direct ask to do so. But we'll talk about something else. Ever since we learned about the Liberal ministers...
The Deputy House Leader is warned. Carry on.
Ever since we learned about Liberal ministers hosting $6,000 dinners with those trying to do business with the government, people have been asking questions. People have been asking, how much money would you have to donate to the Liberal government to change a regulation or a law? Well, one estimate that's just out is $52,700. That is exactly what Ticketmaster and its parent company donated to the Liberals before the government made changes to ticket sale laws in favour of scalpers. Mr. Speaker, the Liberal continued to reveal themselves one scandal at a time. So, Mr. Speaker, how can this government deny the blatant pay-to-play policy that they've operated under?
Mr. Speaker, I've been very clear that that policy is made based on the evidence, based on challenges that are faced in whatever sector, Mr. Speaker, and have nothing to do with fund.
The member from Renfrew-Nipissing Pembroke is warned. You've asked me to go there. I'm going there. Carry on.
That policies have nothing to do with the fundraising that we do, Mr. Speaker. And in fact, the Leader of the Opposition knows full well that we're in the process now of getting consultations in place to go out into the public to have a conversation about how we should change the fundraising rules. There's draft legislation that is going to be out to committee, Mr. Speaker, and I look forward to the input from people around the province on things like third-party advertising, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
On the rules that should be in place around donations to all of our parties, Mr. Speaker,
thank
because
you.
We all operate under the same rules.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. When the change was made last year, John Karastamatis from the Mervis Productions said he believed the government caved to pressure from big ticket holder operations such as Ticketmaster and Maple Leaf Sports and Entertainment. But wait a second. Maple Leaf Sports Entertainment, they happen to donate $30,000 to the Liberal Party. So that's $52,000 and $30,000 for a total of $82,000 from those that benefited from this change. So maybe the Liberals didn't cave to pressure, but rather it appears that government policies can be bought under this Liberal government. Mr. Speaker, if the government has nothing to hide, why would they not welcome our call for a public inquiry? So I'll ask again, will the government accept our request for a public inquiry?
Having thought through what I heard, I will warn the Leader of the Opposition, do not go down there again. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, we're moving forward to reform political fundraising in this province with the Election Finances Act. We look forward to the conversation that will take place over the coming weeks with the public in Ontario about the changes that we're putting forward, the banning of corporate and union donations, reducing the pre-writ spending limits, Mr. Speaker, and limiting third-party advertising. We look forward to the committee discussions. We look forward to suggestions on amendments that might come forward. I was disappointed to hear that that the NDP actually voted against that consultation yesterday, Mr. Speaker. That was surprising, but we are confident that with the intensive consultations that will happen over the summer, they will have a good bill going forward, and we'll be able to reform those rules so they'll be in place for January 2017.
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. As Gord Downie sang, isn't it amazing what you can accomplish when you don't let the nation get in your way? Well, isn't it amazing what the Liberals can accomplish when they don't let ethics get in your way?
The member from Beeses East York is warned. Finish, please.
Mr. Speaker, isn't it amazing what the Liberals can accomplish when they don't let ethics get in the way? The Liberals can hang your head in woe now that they've been caught, but it looks like they still think they have done nothing wrong. Over $80,000 to the Liberal Party coffers from these companies, and then with a stroke of the pen, this government changes the law in their favour. So, Mr. Speaker, my question is, if this government has done nothing wrong, if the Premier feels they have done nothing wrong, why would they not want to clear the air and support our call for a public inquiry?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I'll take Gord Downie's lyrics and his tone over the Leader of the Opposition's anytime. We are moving ahead on reforming the election finances of this province, Mr. Speaker. We're going to do that with the opposition parties or without them, Mr. Speaker. I hope they'll take part. I hope that they will take an active part in the committee discussions. But we're going to be in conversation with the people of this province so that we can get feedback on the kinds of changes that they think are appropriate, Mr. Speaker. We make policy separate from political donations. At the same time, we believe that modernizing fundraising rules is what...
I have three in mind. If I hear it again, you will. Finish, please.
Having said that, we know that modernizing the fundraising rules is what needs to happen. We're moving ahead on that, Mr. Speaker. We look forward to the participation of everyone in the House.
Thank you. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. The government keeps track of the repairs that schools need, and that information is public. If a school has an FCI, something called an FCI, a Facility Condition Index score, over 65%, the state of repair of that school, Speaker, is considered critical. Yesterday I was in Scarborough, where advocates told me about Sir Alexander Mackenzie School, which has a score of 80.
Please.
Which has an FCI score, Speaker, of 85%, and Sir William Osler, which has a score of 84%. Remember, 65% is considered critical, Speaker. These schools are beyond critical. Why has this Premier let Scarborough schools fall into such a state of disrepair?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. You know, the importance of an SCI, or the Facilities Condition Index, is that a board can track the needs of schools, and so that there can be an orderly use of maintenance dollars as those are available, Mr. Speaker. It's only responsible. It's like a municipality having an asset management plan, Mr. Speaker, understanding the condition of your assets so that as you make investments, you can do that in an orderly way, so that it's not random, Mr. Speaker, so that it's not haphazard, but it's actually done in a way that is responsible. That's what an FCI is about, Mr. Speaker, and I am, you know, I am absolutely pleased that the TDSB still has an FCI, that boards across the province have those, so that as they make investments in their schools, Mr. Speaker, they do so in an orderly and a responsible way.
Thank you. Supplementary.
People expect the government to get the basics right, Speaker. In our education system, making sure a school is properly repaired is one of the basics. For example, students in our schools should not have to be wearing winter coats during the winter time while they're in the classroom, Speaker. But we're seeing schools falling apart, not only in Scarborough, but across this province. Can the Premier explain how she's getting something that is so basic so wrong?
Thank you, Premier.
Education.
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you. And as the leader has acknowledged, we in fact do keep track.
Minister, please.
Of the facility condition indexes, so that we have a common measure of the state of repair of schools around the province. And we quite recognize that there are some older schools that require funding. That's why in 2014 we actually announced a specific investment of $1.25 billion over 3 years, specifically for the repair of schools with high FCI indexes. For this year, the 2016-17 year coming up, that investment will amount to $500 million, half a billion dollars, which we are sending to boards, and that's based on the boards with the most high FCIs getting.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, schools in Scarborough have cracked walls, missing ceiling tiles, cracked foundations, broken doors.
The Minister, of Economic Development is warned. Just to make sure you heard me as you continued, you're warned. Finish, please.
These schools could quite literally fall apart unless they're immediately repaired and repaired properly. This is not an environment, Speaker, that encourages learning, nor is it a proper work environment for educators. It sends all the wrong messages, Speaker. So can this Premier tell students and their parents and their educators why she's letting schools fall into this kind of disrepair?
Thank you, Minister.
And I repeat, I would question the degree of disrepair. We do not have any schools that are going to fall down, but we have.
Member from Windsor West is warned. Carry on.
In $1.25 billion. You know, Speaker, over the last several years, we have invested $13 billion in school board capital, and that includes replacing schools that are in need of repair. But we've also directed boards that have what are called proceeds of disposition from selling schools that are no longer needed. That money must also go into school repair.
Answer.
So we have made significant major investments in school repair.
Thank you. New question. The Leader of the Third
Thank
Party.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question, my next question is for the Premier. The Liberals won't tell Ontarians if their local hospital is one of the hospitals that needs hundreds of millions of dollars in maintenance in order to prevent an imminent breakdown. But they provide that information of schools, Speaker. In fact, the Premier just said that that's because they have to ensure that there's an orderly use of maintenance dollars. In fact, she just said it's only the responsible thing to do in order to make sure that the repairs are done in an orderly way, not random, not haphazard. Will the Premier admit now that she will not release information about hospital repair backlogs because she's more worried about bad PR for the Liberal Party than she is about delivering the best care in our hospitals for our patients?
Thank you. You seat it, please. You seat it, please.
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm so glad the Leader of the Third Party asked this question because it really demonstrates the depth of her misunderstanding. Mr. Speaker, the fact is that if she looks at a facility condition index of a school board, she will notice there is no dollar amount attached to the school name. And that's for a very good reason, Mr. Speaker, because the facility condition index indicates the work that needs to be done, indicates where the challenges are, and indicates the rating of that school. But it doesn't say, and these repairs will cost X number of dollars, because that would prejudice the process of getting that school fixed, Mr. Speaker. It's a completely different process than the hospitals, and it just demonstrates that she doesn't understand how we would get those repairs done in the hospitals. It's a different process,
Answer.
Mr. Speaker, and I think that if she looks at the FCI, she'll understand why they're written the way they are.
You see it, please. You see it, please.
Supplementary.
Speaker, all it really shows is the depth of the arrogance of this government. That response to my question shows the depth of the arrogance of this Liberal Premier, Speaker. The Liberals will not tell Ontarians if their hospitals are up to code or not. In the school system, that's something that is quite well known. We know that Ontario hospitals need more than $3 billion worth of repairs, but we don't know which hospital, Speaker. And yet the school boards publicly allow that information to be out there. And yet, for some reason, the Liberals refuse to allow the same information to be made public when it comes to hospitals. We have the information about schools, but the Liberals will not provide it about hospitals. So my question, again, back to the Premier, and perhaps she will answer it this time, why won't she tell us which hospitals need the most repair work, Speaker?
Thank you.
Speaker, the Leader of the Third Party is simply wrong. You do not have the information about how much money it would cost to fix the schools on a facility condition index. The fact is, Mr. Speaker, that what the Leader of the Third Party is asking for is she's asking for the whole negotiation process around the cost of repairs to be undermined by making that information public and then prejudicing the process. So the Leader of the Third Party is saying it doesn't matter what the negotiation is. It doesn't matter what the cost is. Let's just bump the cost up as high as it can be by acknowledging what we think the cost is and by attaching the name of the hospital to it. That would be irresponsible, Mr. Speaker. There are no dollar amounts attached to an FCI from a school board, and the Leader of the Third Party does not seem to understand exactly the damage that would be done if we were to do what she's asking.
Yeah, yeah. Stop the clock. You see it, please? You see it, please? Final.
Final supplement.
Speaker, the lack of understanding that exists in this chamber is this Premier's lack of understanding of the words openness and transparency. We say that, and so does our Financial Accountability Officer, and this is another demonstration of the Liberals refusing to give public information to the public, Speaker. The government is not keeping up with critical repairs and maintenance in our hospitals. And what is worse, in response to our Freedom of Information request, the government admits that they have no plan to deal with any future maintenance needs. Speaker, that means the repair backlog is only going to grow and the situation in our hospitals is only going to get worse. We see what that looks like when we see packed ERs, fewer nurses, fewer beds. People can see the crisis. Every patient in this province can see the crisis, but the Liberals are pretending that it does not exist. Will this Premier stop defending her inaction and start dealing with the crisis in our health care system?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I have a shingled roof on my house, and it's old and aging. In fact, I'm getting leaks into the top floor. I'm probably going to have to replace that.
Order. Minister?
I got a lot of offers, actually, to provide me with contractors just then, Mr. Speaker. But, Mr. Speaker, I'm just amazed at some of the comments coming from the leader of the third party, Mr. Speaker. But the reality is I'm not going to go out there and advertise that I'm prepared to pay $10,000 or $15,000 for a new roof. I'm going to seek out several competent contractors, get them to bid on it, choose the lowest price of the one who can do the best job, Mr. Speaker. That's the same way we need to do it in the hospital system.
New question, the member from Thorn Hill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Last month, while in Israel on a trade mission, the Premier affirmed this government's opposition to the boycott, divestment and sanctions movement against Israel when she said, and I quote, "The BDS position is certainly not mine, nor is it that of our government. I entirely oppose the BDS movement." At the same time, back here in Ontario, this Liberal government was quick to vote down a bill that fought against this new form of anti-Semitism, a bill that would prevent the province of Ontario from conducting business with companies that support this movement. We all know that if an institution organized a movement to marginalize, demonize, and physically attack LGBT communities, this government would be outraged.
Yep.
Yet, when a government-funded institution does this to the Jewish communities, it's justified as free speech.
Minister of Energy is warned. You have wrap-up sentences.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Why did this entire Liberal caucus, with the exception of one brave member, refuse to support our Jewish communities?
Mr. Speaker, let me just say that it was a wonderful opportunity. I was honoured to be able to travel to Israel, Mr. Speaker, and I did, while there, make a statement about our government's opposition and lack of support for the BDS movement. Any movement or any initiative that promotes anti-Semitism or racism or Islamophobia or sexism or homophobia, any movement that chooses to divide or encourages those kinds of that kind of hatred, Mr. Speaker, we're going to oppose it, and we stand opposed to it, and all of our policies, and with our fiber, we will stand against any movement that does that, Mr. Speaker, and that remains our position, Mr. Speaker. It was a huge opportunity for us to travel to Israel and to meet with businesses, to meet with people from higher education, and to form partnerships, Mr. Speaker, based on our knowledge economy, but also based on our cultural ties that are decades deep, Mr. Speaker.
You seated? Sorry, member.
Thanks back to the Premier, Speaker. Premier, you say you oppose the BDS movement, but the problem is you oppose the bill, and you opposed a solution to help combat the growing anti-Semitism in our province and across campuses. A young man named Daniel Shakar appeared at the press conference hosted by the member for Eglinton Lawrence, Mr. Cole, and I. And she said, because of the vocal opposition to BDS, my name was featured on a white supremacist website that has accused Jews of being a member of a reptilian race. I cannot wear a Star of David on campus lest I be harassed. I cannot identify myself as an Israeli without being called a murderer. She says wherever BDS motions are passed, violent anti-Semitism follows. Surely it's time to take a stand. None of us would ever countenance signing a contract with a business that refuses to do business with somebody because it's owned by a woman or a Muslim or any other faith. But somehow we hide behind free speech because business is owned by Jews or by Israelis. Premier, let's do the right thing. Join President Obama, American legislatures, Prime Minister Cameron, and fight back against it.
Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Here's my suggestion, and I made the statement in Israel because I feel very strongly about, as I said, any movement or any initiative that would support anti-Semitism, would support Islamophobia, would support racism, Mr. Speaker. I feel very, very strongly about any movement of that sort. So my suggestion is to this House is let's figure out if we can craft a motion that is not divisive, that is actually unifying in motion in nature, Mr. Speaker, that actually is not flawed and chooses to divide people. Let's see if we can work together. And I made this commitment when I was on the mission, Mr. Speaker, that we would work with the opposition parties, that we would try to come up with a motion that would pass this legislature that would reflect the inclusiveness of all of the members of this legislature, Mr. Speaker. I suggest that we try to do that within the coming weeks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Premier, the people of Grassy Narrows have been told since 1970 not to eat the fish that they've relied on as a central part of their life since time immemorial, because of the mercury that was dumped in their river that makes them sick. They've been asking the Ontario government to fix it ever since. A report released earlier this week says it can be fixed, it can be cleaned, and the fish can be made safe. Many community members are here with us today. Many of the youth who have traveled 1,700 kilometres are watching today. Premier, will you look at these youth from Grassy Narrows who are sitting behind you and tell them that the rivers that make them sick today won't be cleaned tomorrow and will never be cleaned in their lifetime?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I know that the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs is going to want to comment on this, but I want to just say to all of the young people and the people who have travelled from Grassy Narrows that this is something that is of great concern to me and to all of our caucus, Mr. Speaker. I have been to Grassy Narrows. I have talked with the people who have been affected by the mercury in the water and the fish, Mr. Speaker. I want there to be science that we can use to clean up the sediment and to clean up the water and to make sure that that ecosystem is clean, Mr. Speaker. And we have a report now that suggests that there may be a way of doing that. But the first thing the report says is we need to look at some field studies because it's not conclusive. It's not exactly clear exactly how to do that without disturbing the sediment and making the situation worse. That's the question we have to answer. I do not want to make the situation worse. I want to only work to fix it up, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Speaker. When asked on Monday, the Premier said she hadn't read the report. On Tuesday, she said she read the report, but what the report calls for wasn't clear, even though the government has had the final report since April. On Wednesday, we learned that the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs had only received the report that day or the day before, when the government has had it since April. The minister has called the science of the report new. This is not new science. In fact, it's been done in a number of communities across this province for decades. So let's be clear. Enhanced natural remediation is possible. Again, I ask the Premier, will you tell the young people of Grassy Narrows when this government will start the remediation?
Thank you.
The environment and climate change.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
to the environment and climate change.
Thanks. Mr. Speaker, through you to the member opposite and to our good friends in the gallery, we are past the idea of doing more studies to look at the problem. We are now looking very specifically, working with Grassy Narrows First Nation and the federal government to figure out exactly what do we have to do. It's a complex range of sources there in Clay Lake and on the river, and there's sediment and there's atmospheric issues and there's ambient levels of methyl hydrate and mercury. We are going to work very closely through the working group that has been established to ensure that we have proper solutions. The current situation is unacceptable, but we have to make sure, as the Premier said, that we're undertaking efficient, near-term action consistent with the leadership and desires of the community, and on good science that will actually solve the problem and not make it worse. I find it unacceptable.
Thank you.
Will not see this continue on my watch, Mr. Speaker.
Question, the member from Halton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Attorney General. Mr. Speaker, this week is Victims and Survivors of Crime Week. Every year, this week raises awareness about issues facing victims of crime, as well as the services, programs, and laws that can help these victims and their families during difficult—
Stop the clock, please. Sergeant, we're not allowed to have displays in this place, please. If you are insistent on doing so, we'll have to clear the gallery. Thank you. Turn them inside out. If not, we'll have to clear the gallery. That section. Question, please.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As I mentioned, it's Victims and Survivors of Crime Week. We also recognize the remarkable individuals who have put themselves on the front line to help others during crisis. These are often survivors of crimes themselves and have raised the profile of victims' issues in Ontario. Today, we're honoured to have this year's Victim Services Award winners here at Queen's Park, including my constituent, Michelle Barclay. Michelle is one of our unsung heroes and has worked tirelessly to help others. Mr. Speaker, can the Attorney General tell us more about how this program improves services to victims and raises awareness about issues facing victims of crime in Ontario?
Thank you. Attorney General.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
From Alton for this very important question. Our government is committed to increasing the effectiveness of victim services across the province. One step in achieving this goal is to help ensure that local agencies know about and learn from the successes of exemplary individuals and organizations. I want to acknowledge the strength and courage of victims and their family members. I also want to recognize the volunteers, professionals, and organizations for their tireless efforts on behalf of the victim of crime. This morning, I was very proud to meet with all of our award recipients. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for all you're doing on behalf of survivors in the province. Mr. Speaker, it was very moving to hear all the good work that these people are doing in our community. Thank you,
thank
Mr.
you.
Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Attorney General. It's unfortunate, actually, that our award winners are no longer in the gallery. Mr. Speaker, I recently learned that week used to be called National Victims of Crime Awareness Week, but the name was changed to include the term survivor. That's because we recognize that victims of crime are survivors. They are able to overcome trauma and grow to a place of strength, healing, and recovery. That's why Halton resident Michelle was honoured today. For 13 years, her selfless acts of kindness and compassion have earned the recognition of her colleagues and the people she helps. Thank you, Michelle, and thank you to all of those who assist survivors with support and healing. Through events like this morning's, which was emotional, we say no. No to the injustices and indignities experienced by victims of crime. And I'm proud our government has implemented initiatives like our action plan. Can the minister please expand on her efforts to support victim services in this province?
Thank you. Attorney General.
Yes, a good question, Mr. Speaker. When we came into power in 2003, funding for victim services totaled just over $30 million. That number has more than doubled in my ministry to over $67 million. I am incredibly proud of the program like our It's Never Okay action plan against sexual violence and harassment, as well as our effort on behalf of victims of domestic violence, on behalf of rural Ontarians, Indigenous Ontarians, and many others. However, it is the organization and individuals who work tirelessly on the front lines to help victims of crime when they need it the most. I said it this morning, and I say it again today. The award recipients in the room today are role models for us all, and je veux les remercier d'être ici.
And I wish to thank them for being here today and for the work they do in their community.
To the Minister of Energy. A recently published document by the Ontario Energy Board stated that the OEB intends to hide the cost of cap and trade related price increases for natural gas by concealing them as delivery charges in ratepayers' bills. This concealment suggests that the OEB thinks Ontarians do not deserve to know why their rates are going up and that the government is hiding the damage its misguided cap and trade scheme will do to Ontario families. The minister likes to state in this House that the OEB is there to protect Ontario's consumers. How can that be if the OEB is saying that consumers should be kept in the dark regarding the effect of the government's cap and trade scheme, the effect that it will have on natural gas prices?
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, I'm not aware of the document or whatever he's reading, where it comes from, Mr. Speaker. I'd be happy to take a look at it. But the Ontario Energy Board has done tremendous service for the province of Ontario over the last decade or so, Mr. Speaker. They are 100% independent. They represent the interests of consumers in this province, Mr. Speaker. They hear hearings for rate increases and roll them back or even reduce them, Mr. Speaker, below what they've asked for. Mr. Speaker, we're very proud of their job, and I don't know what he's referring to, but they are not accustomed to doing the type of things that he's accusing them of. I will certainly look into what he's saying, but I have trouble believing that the Ontario Energy Board would not, in every instance, be being 100% transparent with the public, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, you point the people to the Ontario Energy Board. Perhaps they've been taking their lead from your government, because you've talked about openness and transparency, and we've yet to see it since this government was elected in 2014. While the minister may wish to stand aside and let the OEB conceal the truth about what happened to energy rates in this province when cap and trade begins to impact our economy, we believe ratepayers have the right to know the truth behind the cost of their natural gas bills. We know this plan will drive up the cost for ratepayers and make home heating and commercial heating in this province less affordable. The OEB and the government are trying to hide this from ratepayers. It's completely unacceptable given that Quebec and California, your cap-and-trade partners, allow separate cap-and-trade line items to appear on their bills. Now, Minister, if you want to say that the Ontario Energy Board and you want to
do an advertisement for them, that's fine.
Question.
But you are used to giving directives. I would suggest it's time for you to give one more. Make sure that cap and trade has a separate line item on natural gas bill. Because
you see it, please. You see it, please. Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the member would know that under this Ontario Energy Board, the price of natural gas has gone down by about 40%. Mr. Speaker, it is down lower than it's been for decades and decades, Mr. Speaker. The public are being very, very well served. Mr. Speaker, it is an independent organization. It goes through... Minister, Speaker, as Minister, I have 100% confidence in the Ontario Energy Board to represent the interests of the consumers of this province. And I don't know what document he's referring to, Mr. Speaker, but they go to every end of the earth, Mr. Speaker, to hear the public, to have delegations come in,
answer.
And to, in the appropriate cases, even reduce increases that have been asked for by LDCs and gas companies, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. Member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Minister of Energy. Earlier this week, the Environmental Commissioner said that conservation was Ontario's cheapest energy option. And she's right. But OPG is proceeding with an expensive nuclear refurbishment plan that will add over $5 per month to our electricity bills on top of everything else that's coming at us. And that's if these nuclear projects come in on budget. Speaker, we know nuclear projects never come in on budget. When Ontario already has a massive energy surplus, adding billions to our electricity bills, why didn't the minister hold back on costly nuclear projects so Ontarians can finally be rewarded, not punished, for their conservation efforts?
Question, thank you. Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to quote from the Commissioner's report to begin with. Quote, Ontario has focused on conserving electricity and natural gas by conservation programs delivered by electric and natural gas utilities and funded by their customers. Both gas and electricity conservation programs have consistently proven to be cost-effective. On the whole, Ontario's investments in electric and natural gas conservation have made sense. That's a quote from the Environment Commissioner, Mr. Speaker. And the member will know that the projections, which have been validated by third parties, Mr. Speaker, shows that the cost of electricity coming from our nuclear generation after the refurbishment, Mr. Speaker, will be at 7.7 cents per kilowatt hour. That is a bargain for the public, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, just a note, conservation is a lot cheaper than that number. Conservation has worked. Conservation has worked in Ontario. We use less electricity to do more. But in Ontario, when we use less, we get to pay more. This is because the government keeps signing new contracts for even more electricity that we don't need. Ontarians have to pay for this electricity whether we use it or not. Ontario now has an electricity surplus far greater than the total output of Pickering. Instead of driving up our electricity bills even further, why won't the minister allow our conservation programs to do what they're supposed to do, reduce energy use and lower our hydro bills?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, again, a quote from the Environment Commissioner. Both gas and electricity conservation programs have consistently proven to be cost-effective when measured by appropriate post-implementation cost-effective tests, Mr. Speaker. That's an independent assessment of our conservation program, Mr. Speaker. And what the member will not talk about is the fact that we have 60% of our generation coming from nuclear, projecting in the future, Mr. Speaker, it will be 50%, and it's 100% emissions-free, Mr. Speaker. We're on the right page on this file, Mr. Speaker, and I don't accept the criticism of the critic.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Etobicoke Centre.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Minister, in December, you released the Patients First, a proposal to strengthen patient-centered health care in Ontario. And at that time, I know that your ministry invited people from across Ontario to provide their feedback on this proposal to strengthen and integrate Ontario's health system. In fact, I myself hosted a consultation, a patient's first consultation, in Etobicoke Centre at Humber Valley United Church, and we had a wonderful turnout and some excellent input from a diverse group of constituents. Thousands of Ontarians, I understand, responded, and they said a range of things, including that, saying that they wanted a system built around the needs of the patient, that that represents the unique needs of all Ontarians, that is where home and community care, primary care, and public health are streamlined, and that promotes health equity and reduces disparities. And I know in my riding, I heard a little bit about the issue about equitable access to care as well. Minister, could you please tell the House about the government's plan to put patients first?
Good question.
Thank you. Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member from Etobicoke Centre for this important question. I want to again acknowledge the many health care leaders who have joined us in the gallery today. Mr. Speaker, later today I will introduce the Patients First Act, which would, if passed, put patients at the centre of a truly integrated health care system. And it would give Ontario's 14 local health integration networks, our LHINs, an expanded role, one that connects all parts of the health care system, including, for the first time, primary care to home and community care, to improve planning and delivery of frontline services for patients. And these proposed changes would mean easier and more equitable access to care, better coordination and continuity of care, a greater focus on health equity and the social determinants of health. And we would also honour our commitment to meaningfully engage Indigenous partners through a separate, a parallel process that will collaboratively identify how we can achieve a transformational change in how care is accessed and delivered to them. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for that thorough and thoughtful response. In Etobicoke Centre, we have one of the largest proportions of seniors in the province, and I know that the issues you're working on touch on people of all ages and all backgrounds, but certainly the seniors that I represent in the community will appreciate hearing what you've just said. Minister, I know that our government has worked hard to ensure that patients are at the centre of the healthcare system. You just referred to that, and I understand that the proposed changes would strengthen local healthcare planning and increase efficiency to allow more funding to flow to where it matters, which is to patients and to patient care. I also have heard and pleased to hear that the government intends to honour the commitment to meaningfully engage with our Indigenous partners as well. So, Minister, could you please provide an update on the status of the Patients First Act?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, thank you again. And Mr. Speaker, our action plan includes expanding access to home and community care and ensuring that every Ontarian has access to a primary care provider. And the proposed legislative changes will articulate our vision for a better, more integrated system, a system that improves access for patients who need to find a new or their first primary care health provider close to home. It will facilitate local health care planning to ensure that patients receive more equitable access to care regardless of where they live. It will establish a formal relationship, Mr. Speaker, between LHINs and local boards of health to support joint health services planning. And it will ensure that caregivers and families' voices are at the heart of our entire system and that it's accountable to patients and connects them with the care that they need. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Dufferin-Caledon.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Children and Youth Services. Earlier this week, in responding to a question, the minister stated that, quote, IBI and ABA are essentially the same thing. And yet, I have minutes from the Minister of Education's Advisory Council on Special Education, where your autism manager said, and I'll quote directly from the minutes, challenges with current autism services. ABA may not be intensive enough, and regression can occur between blocks of service. Will the minister admit she was wrong to suggest ABA and IBI are essentially the same?
Thank you. Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you. I want to thank the member for the question. I believe what I said, Speaker, was that the difference is intensity. Intensity is a key factor in terms of making or responding to the individual needs of a child, and that's exactly why many service providers have had hundreds of meetings to date with families to talk about the individual requirements of their autistic child going forward, to plan their transition plan going forward, and to for families who are coming off the IBI wait list to make sure they're fully aware of their options in terms of the $8,000 of direct funding that they can use immediately. So, yes, Speaker, we are developing a new program that's one autism program. There'll be more individualized, one point of entry, one point of assessment, and making sure we're supporting these children going forward.
Just makes sense.
Thank you, supplementary.
Minister, the more meetings that you have, the more confusion that there is, and there are more children being kicked off service. Parents understand that ABA and IBI are not the same. Board-certified analysts understand ABA and IBI are not the same. Your own children and youth autism manager understands they're not the same. When will the minister start listening to the experts and stop removing children from accessing IBI therapy?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you, Minister.
Frank, I would say, and I think my colleagues would say, the more we meet with families, the more helpful that is. And that's the feedback that we've been getting. And where members from all sides of the House need more information, my ministry's liaison is there to help. The service providers are there to help, and the regional offices are there to help. Because, Speaker, at the end of the day,
the member from Dufferin-Caledon is warned. Finish, please.
Speaker, the feedback we're getting is that more and more families are understanding the path forward. More and more families want to just have that clear path about how the system is going to support their child, and to recognize that we're moving to a system, Speaker, that recognizes there's no age cutoff for autism, and kids who are in IBI will continue in IBI, and they will have their ongoing clinical assessments to determine.
Thank you. New question. The member from Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Transportation. Speaker, unfortunately, just prior to the holiday weekend, my community was witness to yet another multi-vehicle accident that resulted in a fatality. This is the second such tragedy that's happened on the same stretch of road that is yet to be widened on Highway 3. Second in the span of a month. This is no longer a coincidence, Speaker. This is a pattern. The government's own report from 2006 calls for the complete widening of that stretch due to the volume of traffic that it supported then. That volume of traffic has now increased by 30%. So despite the data, the petitions, the motions, and letters from all local municipalities calling on this government to fulfill its promise to our community, the Minister of Transportation refuses to act on the third and final phase of this important link in my community. We cannot wait one more day. People are refusing to drive on this highway, and people are losing their lives. Will the minister rise from his seat today, fulfill his obligation to our community, and immediately call for the initiation of the completion
Thank
of
you.
Highway 3?
Minister of Transportation.
Thanks very much, Speaker. I want to begin by thanking the member from Essex for not only the question today, but for, frankly, the advocacy that he's brought to this particular issue. I know in his region, I do understand very clearly that this is a vitally important project or initiative that the community is looking at, Speaker, and I understand the urgency. I've said this many times in the legislature, and frankly, Speaker, outside the legislature, any time that there's a fatality or an injury on a road or a highway anywhere in the province of Ontario, my heart goes out to those involved, to the families of those that are involved, Speaker. It's one of the reasons that this government, under the leadership of our Premier, has moved forward so aggressively with a massive transportation infrastructure build-out, Speaker. And in this particular case, in this particular part of Ontario, I know that the member knows that over the last number of years, our government has invested $50 million to widen 13 kilometres already of this, Speaker. I know that we have more work to do. I understand that, and I'm happy to have a conversation with that member.
Thank you.
And frankly, Speaker, meet with municipal representatives from that community.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. The voices of our community couldn't be any clearer. We need that highway widened now. It's a 10-year-old promise that this government made to our community. Speaker, I want to quote my predecessor, Bruce Crozier. He said, quote, "The objective of the construction is to increase the safety of the 33-kilometer highway, the region's main artery between Windsor and much of the county, including towns of Essex, Kingsville, and Leamington. If safety was the priority back when Bruce said it, then it is most definitely the priority today." Sure. Speaker, the road is aptly named after Bruce Crozier. It's called Bruce Crozier's Way due to his efforts to have that section of the highway widened over his tenure of 17 years in this place. Bruce Crozier's Way was to stick to your promise, deliver on your promise, and do what you say you're going to do. If he were here today, his staff member said that he would be disgusted by the actions of this government and the lack of action. I call on the minister, we implore on the minister to fulfill his promise, honour Bruce's legacy, get the money flowing to our community, and finish Thank Highway you. 3.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you, Minister.
Well, thanks. Thanks very much, Speaker. Again, I thank the member from Essex for the follow-up question, Speaker. You know, I had the opportunity many years before serving as an MPP to work here in this building as a staff person, and in fact, Mr. Crozier was someone who I knew well and respected a great deal, Speaker. As a at that point in my case, a much younger man who had the chance to work here at that time, and I understand profoundly the importance of the advocacy that Bruce Crozier brought to this particular discussion, Speaker. The reason that we have been in position to expand the 13 kilometres so far and to invest the money to widen the highway so far, Speaker, was because of the advocacy of that member. Speaker, I mentioned already in my first answer that I'm happy to continue the discussion with that member and with municipal leaders from his community, from his region, about this particular project,
answer.
Because I understand the importance, Speaker. But whether we're talking about this particular region in Essex or any other part of the province, we are investing billions of dollars in highways in every corner of the province.
Thank you.
We will continue to do so, and I sincerely hope that...
Thank you. New question, the member from Davenport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question this morning is to the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure. That's right. Welcome back. Yes, welcome back, Minister. It's wonderful to see you here back in the House. Mr. Speaker, recently Forbes magazine reported that organizations that are looking for a competitive edge have embraced diversity and that leading enterprises have managed to tap into employing people with disabilities. Actually, earlier this morning, I had the pleasure of speaking at a conference organized by the Creative Spirit Arts Centre for my riding of Davenport that has done tremendous work to raise awareness to the barriers faced by artists with disabilities, especially employment barriers. The Forbes report I refer to is an important reminder during National Accessibility Awareness Week, which Ontarians all across the province are marking until June 6. This timing gives us great opportunity to discuss what the province is doing to improve employment prospects for people with disabilities. Because, Mr. Speaker, despite progress, we have much work left to be done on this file. So, Speaker, through you to the Minister, what is this government doing to improving disability accessibility?
Thank you. Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
You've got to get back used to that again, Mr. Speaker. Thank you for that. And Mr. Speaker, thank you for giving me my first warning this morning. Evidence, I think, that I am back in a fighting trend. I know you probably didn't like doing that. And I want to thank the member for the question. Speaker, the fact is Ontario is a global leader in accessibility. First in the world to move to a modern regulatory regime that mandates accessibility. First in the world requiring staff to be trained on accessibility. First in Canada with legislation that sets out clear goals and timeframes. And Ontario is currently the only jurisdiction in Canada that has enforceable standards. That being said, Mr. Speaker, there's still much more work to do, and very good reasons to do that. The 2010 Martin Prosperity Institute indicated that there's $7.9 billion, Mr. Speaker, out there for us to gain in our economy if we're to become more successful. Mr. Speaker, there's still more work to do, and we're determined to do it. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
So thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the minister for that answer as well and all the great work that he and his ministry have been doing on this particular file. And as I said, I'm an advocate as well for people with disabilities, especially with the Creative Spirit Art Centre in my riding and having been at that conference this morning. So I want to thank the minister once again for that answer. But Minister, while these achievements are impressive, it seems clear that legal standards will be difficult to implement without full buy-in from the private sector. Lately, I was encouraged to hear that 25% of the largest Canadian public companies indicate an interest in this market. And I spoke to you earlier about the artists with disabilities facing employment challenges and what they can actually gain if they were employed to be able to bring economic value and to bring personal satisfaction to their work. But it is always important to ensure that businesses do not see the standards as too cumbersome. So, Minister, what are you doing to ensure business?
Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member for her great advocacy on this issue. And she's absolutely right. Business buy-in is absolutely crucial if we're going to be able to drive that cultural shift that's so important for us to move this file ahead. We're working with businesses and other stakeholders toward the accessibility certification program, which will make it easier for people to identify accessible businesses, celebrate accessible businesses and organizations. We're also working with our accessibility partners toward supporting a TripAdvisor-like application that allows anyone to rate businesses on their ability to welcome clients with disabilities. In April, we hosted the Accessibility Innovation Showcase, which highlighted technological innovation, Mr. Speaker, so that we can ensure that that innovation helps to lever the playing field for people
Answer.
With disabilities in their homes and businesses. Mr. Speaker, as I said, there's still a lot more work to do, but we're determined to make Ontario accessible and continue our role as a global leader in this area.
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker.
We have a deferred vote on the motion of third reading of Bill 186, an act to establish the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. All members, please take your seats. All members, please take your seats. Thank you. On Wednesday, June 1st, 2016, Ms. Hunter moved third reading of Bill 186, an act to establish the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. All those in favour, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Nackey.
Mr. Nackey.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mrs. Sandals.
Mrs. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orazetti.
Mr. Orazetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Couteau.
Mr. Couteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Caudry.
Caudry.
Mrs. Albanese.
Mrs. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Mrs. Mangat.
Mangat.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Thibault.
Mr. Thibault.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East, Stoney Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East, Stoney Creek.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natashek.
Mr. Natashek.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jelena.
Madame Jelena.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr.
Harding. Mr. Harding.
Mr.
McLeod.
Mr. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller Perry Samuskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Samuskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mrs. Marteau.
Mrs. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipe.
Mr. Pettipe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
The ayes are 70, the nays are 25.
They oppose the Canada Pension Plan.
The ayes being 70, the nays being 25, I declare the motion carried. Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and be entitled as in the motion. We have a deferred vote on the motion for closure of the motion for third reading of Bill 135, an act to amend several statutes and revoke several regulations in relation to energy conservation and long-term energy planning. Call in the members. This will be a five-minute bell. Thank you. On May 5, 2016, Mr. Shirley moved third reading of Bill 135, an act to amend several statutes and revoke several regulations in relation to energy conservation, long-term energy planning. Madame Lalonde has moved that the question be now put. All those in favour of Ms. Lalonde's motion, please rise one at a time. You're recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mrs. Sandals.
Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orazetti.
Mr. Orazetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Caudry.
Mr. Caudry.
Mrs. Albanese.
Mrs. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Mrs. Mangat.
Mrs. Mangat.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Ms. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. You're recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mrs. Marteau.
Mrs. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Monsieur Bisson.
Monsieur Bisson.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natashek.
Mr. Natashek.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Monsieur Montauk.
Monsieur Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French. The ayes are 54, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 54 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Shirelli has moved third reading of Bill 135, an act to amend several statutes and revoke several regulations in relation to energy conservation and long-term energy planning. Is it the pleasure of the House the motion carry?
No.
I heard a no. All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please say nay. In my opinion, the ayes have it. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bell. Shirley has moved third reading of Bill 135, an act to amend several statutes and revoke several regulations in relation to energy conservation and long-term energy planning. All those in favour, and most please that rise one at a time, be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mrs. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orazetti.
Mr. Orazetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr.
Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Couteau.
Mr. Couteau.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Kadri.
Mr. Kadri.
Mrs. Albanese.
Mrs. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Mrs. Mangas.
Mrs. Mangas.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerlin.
Ms. Domerlin.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the
court. Mr. Yakubowski.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hardeman.
Mr. Hardeman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Yakubowski.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Miller, Perry, South Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry, South Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nicholas.
Mr. Nicholas.
Mrs. Marteau.
Mr. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Tabin.
Mr. Tabin.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Shibisong.
Mr.
Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East, Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East, Stony Creek.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natashak.
Mr. Natashak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jelena.
Madame Jelena.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Shimanta.
Ms. Shimanta.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
The ayes are 54, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 54 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried.
Third reading of the bill, troisième lecture, projet de loi.
Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and entitle as in the motion. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 1 p.m. this afternoon.